Good evening. Thanks for coming out tonight. My name is Mark Hamagonian. I am the Director of Academic Affairs at the National Association for Armenian Studies and Research, that is NAASR, based in Belmont, Mass. Two words about NAASR. NAASR was established 60 years ago in order to create and sustain the field of Armenian studies in the U.S. at a time when there was as yet no chairs or programs or permanent institutions of any kind devoted to Armenian studies in the United States. Since establishing the first two Armenian studies chairs in the U.S. at Harvard and at UCLA in the 1950s and 1960s, NAASR has supported Armenian studies programs, scholars, publications, organized and funded numerous conferences and symposia, amassed one of the largest Armenian research libraries in the diaspora, and developed the most active and diverse series of lectures and public programs on Armenian topics of any Armenian organization. That's two words. That's all well and good, but like any Armenian organization, and I think like any ethnic organization, and probably like any organization, period, NAASR needs to establish ties to a younger generation and to get a sense of its interests and concerns. It was for this reason that a committee was established consisting of Dr. Seda Ebrahimi, Judy Sarian, Stepan Pelikian, Girard Balaya, and myself that planned this program in conjunction with our partners and will devise others with an eye towards expanding the breadth of our programming and connecting with a younger audience. That indeed is why we're here tonight, and it's nice that you're here tonight too. In addition to thanking everyone who is here, I particularly want to thank our distinguished moderator and panelists whom we will meet momentarily. I want to express NAASR's gratitude to our co-sponsors at the Northeastern Armenian Students Association for their cooperation in hosting this program, to Professor Leon Janikian, the association's advisor and a former NAASR board member, to the MIT Armenian Society, and to the AGBU Young Professionals Boston, as well as to the numerous other groups who have helped to get the word out. We value your help and your input, which will help us to do our own work more effectively. Let me call attention to the questionnaires that have been getting distributed around the room, in which Dr. Ebrahimi, as in the back of the room right now, please get one and fill one out. We would ask you to provide your feedback and your email addresses so that we may add you to our distribution list and you can hear about our events and programs and hopefully come to some. You can also follow us on Facebook. Please do that as well. At the end of the evening, we will have a drawing from the filled out questionnaires, and one lucky person who completes the questionnaire will win $1 million. Actually a book. I would at this moment like to ask our chairman, Rafi Agayan, to come up and say a few words of greeting as well. Rafi.
Good evening. I'll stay with the two words. On behalf of the Board of Directors of NAASR, I welcome you all to this, our first youth-oriented function. It's very encouraging to see a good mix of young faces, and I hope to see you more often at the regular NAASR functions at our headquarters in Belmont, Massachusetts. I'm sure this evening is going to be very challenging for you to follow, and I hope you will get a lot out of it. I'll see you soon again. Take care.
We are pleased that although Northeastern's president, Joseph Aoun, could not be here tonight, he was gracious and kind enough to record a message which we would now like to present. So, Mr. President.
You know, because of your meaning, what I have done is prepared a whole plate of baklava. And I think it's to taste them and consider that they are good. If they are good, then you leave the rest for the meaning. Would you like one or two? Well, you don't trust my cooking? Be honest with me.
This is so good.
Dude, it's very good because it's fresh today. What about this one? That's you.
Can I have another piece?
Of course you can have another piece. Listen, you cannot have a small one anymore. You have to finish everything now. And that's it. Everything is good. What do you think? Did you work out today? Oopsie. You know what I realized? We only have 5 pieces for the whole event. What shall we do?
I know a local Armenian baker who's also a Northeastern alumnus.
What's his name?
Sunkis.
So what shall we do? Shall we go get some of there?
This is Master's
Bakery. We have this event here on campus. Will you get us a tray of baklava?
Yes, we can prepare fresh baklava for you.
How long will it take you? Half a day?
We can do that.
Thank you, Sarkis.
And good luck with the event.
Take care.
Thank you.
I wish I could be with you. Sarkis is going to send us a full tray of baklava. Enjoy it. Paria Koja. I'll be there with you next time.
In thinking about what kind of program to put together for tonight, there was agreement that it should focus on something that affects all Armenians living in the diaspora, the question of Armenian identity, or identities, plural. One could take an academic approach to this, but instead we opted to choose diverse panelists who could talk about their own life experiences and impressions. And when the issue of a moderator came up, we knew right away who it had to be, Middlesex Sheriff Peter Koutoujian. Not only is Sheriff Koutoujian a prominent and dedicated member of the Armenian American community, he is also genuinely interested in and has spoken about some of the issues we will hear about tonight. Peter Koutoujian is the grandson of Armenians who fled the Ottoman Empire during the Armenian Genocide. He's a graduate of Bridgewater State University, the New England School of Law, and holds a master's degree in public affairs from the Harvard Kennedy School of Government. Peter represented the 10th Middlesex District in the Mass State House, which includes Watertown, Waltham, and Newton. While serving in the legislature, he was the lead sponsor of the annual Armenian Genocide commemoration at the State House for many years. In addition, Peter Koutoujian has authored legislation and spent several years spearheading the efforts to win approval of the Armenian Heritage Park on the Kennedy Greenway in Boston, which opened in May of 2012. He was overwhelmingly elected in November 2012 to the office of Sheriff of Middlesex County, where he's continued to build an admirable record of impressive accomplishments. In 2011, Sheriff Koutoujian's work on behalf of the Armenian community earned him the Ellis Island Medal of Honor. And in 2012, Sheriff Koutoujian received the prestigious Mekhitar Ghosh Medal from Armenian Prime Minister Sarkisian in recognition of his leadership of the Armenian American community. It is my pleasure to welcome Sheriff Peter Koutoujian and to place the rest of the evening in his hands. Hey, Mr. Sheriff.
Good evening. Good evening.
Good evening.
Well, I've got to be honest, when it was just announced that we were going to get a video greeting, I've seen about a zillion of those video greetings, and they've never been anything as good as that. So that was what a wonderful way to start out our evening tonight. I want to say thank you to the organizers of tonight's forum. Mark had asked me some months ago if I would be available on this Friday night. And generally, I try not to commit many months ahead on a Friday or Saturday night, because we all know it seems like a good idea months ahead. And when it comes time to that evening, you've got many other things to do. You're exhausted, you're tired, and you simply don't want to go out. But when Mark Mamagonian asks and says, you have something important to say, we really need for you to be there, we'd really like for you to be there, I didn't hesitate and I answered almost immediately, such as the power of NAASR and Mark Mamagonian and his leadership, because he is one of those leaders that, quite honestly, I will follow. And so I want to say thank you to Mark for this invitation. To Stepan Piligian, Jerry Balayan, Judy Sarayan, Seda Ibrahimi, and Leon Janikian, thank you very much for all the work that you put, and Rafi, of course, all the work that you put into making tonight's event happen. What I really like about this, I see a lot of young people out there too. And all too often, for so many Armenian events, we see people, the same people we see at so many events. and we don't get to see some of the young people that are here tonight, who are truly the future of our people, the future of our diaspora community. And to the organizations hosting tonight's discussion, NAASR, the National Association for Armenian Studies and Research, the Northeastern University Armenian Students Association, the MIT Armenian Society, AGBU Young Professionals Boston, thank you also for putting out the word, spreading the word, and inviting me tonight. My final welcome is to our panelists, Armine, Afeyan, Dr. Areg, Danagoulian, Alison, Hamlin, and Anahis, Kechejian. Thank you for taking the time to share with us your experiences and the thoughts. And I'm really looking forward to some of your perspectives, because all too often, we've got people of age, I will include myself among there, professing how we should be thinking and what we should be doing. And all too often, we don't hear from some of our youngest and brightest from our future. And so I'm really excited to hear some of what they have to say. I want to speak briefly about my family's journey. It began in the United States in 1918. And when my ancestors fled the genocide from Maraş, Turkey, each person in this room has a story just like that. In fact, just today, I was meeting with some of my corrections officers, starting a new program with field. Are you able to shut that door for me, sir? Thank you. Field training program. One of my officers had an accent. And I knew who this young officer was, but not many corrections officers have accents. He was from Yugoslavia, and he was asked to tell his story about his coming to this country, escaping conflict in his home country, fleeing, I think, to Germany for a period of time, and coming to the United States. And aside from perhaps the issue of genocide itself being common, everything else he told me was so common to our experience. It was wonderful to see someone like that inside the Middlesex Sheriff's Office, with an immigrant experience, having come through so much, having a diaspora experience, and embracing this country, and all that's good about this country, was really wonderful. Because quite honestly, people that don't have that diaspora and immigrant experience don't appreciate what we have over here. I see this in generations of young people that grew up here in the United States that don't have what we have, our own experience, that don't appreciate what we appreciate, that don't strive the way that we strive. And he was a young man that was not Armenian, but his story was the same as ours in so many ways. And it was powerful for me to see. Many of our families lived beyond Ottoman rule in long-established communities of Syria, Iran, Ethiopia, India, even the United States. So what is our shared identity as members of the Armenian diaspora dispersed throughout the four corners of the globe? Is it the honor of being the first Christian nation? Is it our unique language, cuisine, music, and literature and innovation? Do the horrors of our past, like the genocide or the devastating earthquake that hit 26 years ago this week, define us? Is it that we identify ourselves with celebrities like the Kardashians? I just want to say right now, I hope not. Or is it because we have a small, recognized nation of Armenia that we, while it is not the size of historic Armenia, is something that we were able to call our motherland and somehow connects us in this land of immigrants? Or is it our fight for Karabakh, for independence of Karabakh, for our ethnic Armenian brothers and sisters? William Saroyan reminds us that despite the horrors and destruction that our people have persevered through, we can come together and create a new Armenia as we do every day. But what does that mean today? Tonight we ask this question to members of our emerging generation, our future leaders. How do we look into our future? How are we connected to our community here? And also, how we are linked to our motherland, Armenia. I often hear about the debate, where to focus our energy, our activity, and our financial support. And we are asked so often to support so many different groups for so many different Armenian causes, all of them worthy. Should we be strengthening our local Armenian schools, our cultural organizations, our churches and political organizations right here in Boston, LA, Chicago, and New York and New Jersey? Or do we work to strengthen the Republic of Armenia politically, economically, and socially, putting the viability of that nation, our motherland, before our local community? Or should we put our effort into recognizing the independence of Karabakh? Or is it a blend of all three? I'd like to give you just a brief perspective, my perspective, that I've spoken about before through NAASR, as a matter of fact. And that is a perspective, speaking of Zabtunk. Zabtunk refers to a period in the 19th century of Armenian history. period, also called the reawakening, the rebirth, the metamorphosis, the revival, the renaissance, sometimes called the intellectual flowering. I am challenging all of us to strive for a 21st century Zugtung by our community right here in America. This awakening that could achieve both, to build a coalition and community entrenching Armenian Americans into their cities and towns, and end up moving up to the state and federal level, and also give us the tools to support a strong Armenia, a strong Artsakh, and achieve recognition for the genocide as well. The challenge to this day that political leadership is largely external to our community, to the Armenian community itself, when one considers it. Something that we're aware of, but we really don't think about it as much as we should. The challenge that the Armenian community faces is becoming part of the centers of political power and having a seat at the table, not merely influencing those with seats at the table. As a community, for various reasons, pursuing a career in public service has not been something that we have connected with and instilled in our young people, our children, and our grandchildren. To be honest, well, let's be honest, how many of you were told by your parents to become a physician or a lawyer or an engineer? All very noble professions with which or from which we can provide for our families. Something very important, along with artists. But these are all wonderful professions, but so are being an artist, an educator, or trades. And as all these professions are respectable, necessary, and enabled us to support our families, as well as increase our quality of life as a community, but public service and the striving for political office and public office must play a greater role in our lives, I believe. These need to be on par with every other profession we encourage our youth to consider and to pursue. All that is fundamentally great about this country was achieved through its political leadership. The abolition of slavery, the enfranchisement of the right to vote for all, the protections of our civil rights, all were established by civil leaders who held public office and remains protected by those in public office today. Human rights, civil rights, and the good of the United States, including the issues near and dear to the Armenian American community, are all determined by those in public office today. And I believe that it is in public office, elected and appointed and otherwise, is where Armenian Americans should consider being in the future. I have been privileged to serve in public office for the past 25 years. So when you're asking hearing from the youth, I still consider myself a kid, actually. I'm still a kid from Waltham. I'm still a kid that went to Sahab Mizrahi School over at St. James. I'm still the kid that, you know, goes to Holy Cross Armenian Catholic Church. I'm still that kid. And during this time of the 25 years, I have had the honor of serving the people of my community, both Armenian and non-Armenian. I have learned a lot about the struggles we have in common with our non-Armenian brothers and sisters as we strive to create better towns, a better commonwealth, a better country, and indeed a better world for all of us and all of our families. Justice for and the lessons of the Armenian genocide are part of what drives me to become more engaged, networked, and a more accomplished public servant. Those I work with learn the importance of and contemporary relevance of the Armenian genocide through the very work I do every day on behalf of my constituents. And even today was an opportunity for me to speak with a bunch of young corrections officers that never had heard about the Armenian genocide, with this young Yugoslavian officer, and speak about what our people went through. And was recognized by him immediately, which was a wonderful opportunity once again to teach what we have gone through, to teach about our genocide. Justice for and the lessons of the Armenian genocide. So last year I had the honor of running for Congress to represent the 5th Congressional District. And while I did not win that race, I believe that as a community, we had a great victory. Because I saw hundreds of them, Armenian Americans, not only donate to my campaign, but also roll up their sleeves and get involved in that campaign. And dozens of high schoolers on the verge of going to college, and many college students making career choices, were active participants in the campaign, and I can see a number of them that are here tonight. And I say thank you very much for your leadership in that as well. It makes me proud to see you, have seen you then, and to see you here tonight continuing this legacy. Sitting side by side, many of the people in their 60s and 70s, making call after call after call every single day. And to see young people, 16 years old, 17 years old, right beside Nevat, Koutoujian, and so many other great members of our, and Anahis, so many other members of our, they weren't dialing quite as quickly, but they were so effective. And it was wonderful to see generations of Armenian Americans together. They learned about the political process and networked with their non-Armenian peers, and they shared their story in a process that made our community not just more mainstream, but much stronger as well. And many of them went on to work on campaigns for other state and federal candidates in the last year, and started by getting involved in my campaign, which started with that, and that makes me very proud. It's my hope that many of them become student government leaders, municipal leaders, members of their state legislators, or even United States Congress. If I can't do it, I want one of them to do it. We have had a few Armenian Americans serve in presidential administrations, but we need more. Campaigns like mine, like ours, like the ones that take place regularly throughout our communities, is where all of this begins. It is where Armenian Americans need to be. It is where Armenian Americans start towards the path of public service and political empowerment. And we must be aware that despite the looming 100th anniversary of the Armenian genocide, 100 years genocide, this cannot be accomplished overnight. The modern Armenian Renaissance, writes Ronald Suni, was not a spontaneous release of deep-seated Armenian spirit, but the product of hard political and intellectual work by Armenian scholars, teachers, and political activists. And I believe this is what we must do starting now. Because I want to make sure that our young leaders get a chance to speak for a little bit longer, I'm going to wrap up by suggesting that, you know, as we watch in horror what's happening to Armenians in Syria, it has challenged me to think about the process of my own life and what we must do as a community to become more engaged and more unified. Because no one's speaking of our community in Syria right now. No one's even aware that we have a community in Syria. No one's aware that our community is suffering right now in Syria. It's not even part of our conversation as a country. Constructive engagement exists. Just like in September when I participated in the Diaspora Conference in Armenia, where 1,000 participants from all over the world came to discuss how we can work together, which was pretty amazing experience to see Armenians from all around the world, born maybe in Lebanon or Syria, and having grown up in Australia, and having the most unusual accent you can ever imagine, from the south, from Texas, and from all around the world. It was really empowering, and yet when we came together, we created a new Armenia right there, and we were all as one. We felt like we were all family, and I know there was a number of you that were there for that. That was wonderful. We also need to build coalitions beyond Armenians. I just returned from Israel. It was a trip hosted, it was a counterterrorism trip, where 15 chiefs of police, Secret Service, and U.S. Marshals went, sponsored by the Anti-Defamation League, with government officials from around here. And what did I do when I was over there? I invited the ADL into the Armenian Quarter. We had a dinner with our Archbishop. And it was there, this beautiful dinner, which was one of the highlights of the entire trip, by the way, that they all became to know even more about the Armenian genocide, and where, by the way, the Patriarch actually asked this organization to lobby the Israeli government for the recognition of the Armenian genocide. Right? That's where it goes. And many of my colleagues opened up new doors to conversations as well. This is also an opportunity to build coalitions, unfortunately, with others that have suffered human rights atrocities. And recently, you might even know that I was able to go to Greece and connect with our Greek, you know, counterparts. We have to remember there were 352,000 Pontian Greeks that suffered through our same genocide. And there wasn't an Armenian genocide or a Christian genocide. We have certainly done more with our recognition of genocide than the Greeks did. That's why they actually flew me over to speak in their Constitution Square, Syntagma Square, to speak about our genocide. That's where they intend to bring me back in May to go to Pontus, the Pontus region, to speak again about the Armenian genocide. Groups that we should be joining with to remember their genocide and our genocide, a Christian genocide. I want to say that it has been a wonderful experience for me to be by birth Armenian, but I would choose to be Armenian no matter what. Many of you know that my mother is Irish, but she was the one that drove me into my Armenianism more than my father, who was the Amedegatsi child, the youngest child of the family that came here. And it is my blessing to be not just 100% Armenian, but also 100% Irish. And how lucky that we can all say that we can also be 100% American. Thank you. I'm going to to ask each of the panelists to speak. And before each one speaks, they're going to speak for about a five-minute presentation. I'm going to introduce each one before they speak individually so that you can remember who they are when they're about to speak. And the first is going to be, by the way, we brought the A team. I say that literally and figuratively because literally they are the A team. Well, actually, figuratively they are a team, but all their names begin with A, so they're the A team throughout. I know that the A is a very powerful letter in there's so many A names in Armenian. But Armine Afeyan was born with a Swedish mother and an Armenian father. Many of you might know her dad, Nubar, of course, a great Armenian-American here. Armine and her siblings were raised in a culturally balanced household where they have embraced all cultures. Armine graduated from Yale in 2012 with a BA in political science, concentrated in post-Soviet conflict and development. And while she's not in her day job at a marketing tech company, she's fulfilling her passion for Armenian culture and history, serving on committees of the Friends of Armenian Heritage Park and the Armenian Tree Project. Currently, she's working on Armenian Genocide Centennial Commemorative events on the national and local level, with the vigil in the park returning for the third year this April 24th. Armine, thank you very much.
First, I'd like to thank NAASR, MIT, Armenian Society, Northeastern Armenian Students Association, AGBYP, for hosting and organizing this event. I'd also like to thank my fellow panelists and Chair Koutoujian for facilitating what I'm sure will be a great discussion. And I'd also like to thank you all for being here to listen. So my take on Armenian identity is inseparable from my upbringing, so please indulge me while I give you some necessary context. With a Swedish mother and an Armenian father, my siblings and I grew up in a mixed household. For every Abaka dance class, there was a Swedish bedtime song. With every morning spent in Saturday or Sunday school came an afternoon of baking our favorite Swedish cinnamon rolls. I've grown up 100% Armenian and 100% Swedish. Wrote this before we said it, I was not stealing. and I've loved every minute of it. To be fair, I can say that I don't really know anything else. But where most people would expect a cultural clash, I've actually seen a cultural complement. This balance has definitely informed my perception of Armenian identity. I attended St. Stephen's through kindergarten and then continued on with Saturday and Sunday school throughout my childhood. I danced in Abaka for 11 years. That's a lot of time learning about Bartan Danagoulian and jumping around in tights for And yet, I can't remember a time where this felt unnatural to me, even as I went to school with my American friends in Lexington. They'd go to brownies, I'd be in Armenian lessons, I'd come home to dinners of Mante and Matsun, and they'd have meatloaf with whatever it is that you eat with meatloaf, because I'm still not sure. I can't remember feeling self-conscious about being so ethnic relative to my more white bread American classmates, so I'm going to make the bold, likely false assertion that I just wasn't. Interestingly enough, I was more insecure about my Armenianness around my fellow Armenians. It wasn't a constant feeling, and certainly didn't dominate the swell of pride I felt when I took to the stage with my friends to share our sweet Abaka dance moves to our adoring fans, which were, of course, just our parents. But every time a disparaging, well, you're only half, came my way, it stung. Whispers of Oldar weren't altogether foreign, and there were times when I felt like I had to justify or prove my Armenianness to others around me. I'd grown up actively engaged in the culture I loved so much, but sometimes it felt like it just wasn't enough. I just wasn't enough. These days, my siblings and I joke cheekily about our Odar status. The alienation I felt periodically when I was younger has, for the most part, given way to an Armenian self-identification that either shields me from this type of ignorant commentary, or it just doesn't happen anymore. And while I sincerely hope for the latter, I know the former is also a possibility. To those who say I'm only half, I concede that yes, half my family is Armenian, the other half is Swedish. But I maintain that if you meet either side of my family, you are going to be left saying, damn, those Swedes are really Armenian, and vice versa. Furthermore, I'm actually 6'1", so that makes me kind of more Armenian than most parents, so there's that. All joking aside, though, as I got older, more and more of my Armenian identity became tied up in the Republic of Armenia itself. When I was 13, I embarked on what would become one of the more formative journeys in my life. My father had just started working with a number of other diaspora Armenians around the world on the Armenia 2020 project, a national development private-public partnership. In a scene truly reflective of my upbringing, we were at my family's summer place on the Baltic coast, enjoying a balmy Swedish summer day, which tops out at about 60 degrees Fahrenheit, when a call came in asking him to go to Yerevan for some initial government meetings. It would be the first time he'd visited Armenia since his childhood in Beirut. He invited me to come along for the ride. And boy, did I ever go along for the ride. My cousin Rafi is here tonight. Hey, Rafi. Can testify to the fact that I spent most of the trip in tears. Crying in churches, tearing up in Republic Square, whining in the Marriott lobby, and then it all, it all came to a head at Vernissage when I exploded into gut-wrenching sobs. So I could sit here and tell you that this was the culmination of all the sights and sounds I saw in my motherland incarnate. That would be a huge lie. I missed my mom. But between all the tears, a vivid portrait of Armenian life took shape in my head and took hold of my imagination. I saw Ararat for the first time in person. If you haven't yet, make it happen. That first breathtaking view is worth it. I imagine it's a feeling people have when they meet their life icon for the first time. It's not to say that I've idolized a mountain my whole life, because who does that? but Ararat's basically a veritable Armenian celebrity. So it was kind of like that. But I digress. That first trip triggered something in me. I went home hell-bent on learning more. I found my academic passion in studying the Armenian case, first in high school from a more simplistic historical angle, and then as I pursued my political science degree, I found the country to be such an awesome fusion of my gut passion for all things Armenian and a fascinating case from a geographic, political, and religious standpoint. I went on to spend a summer in Armenia, living in Yerevan with the AQPU Summer Internship Program, working for one of 2020's spin-offs, the National Competitiveness Foundation of Armenia, as they prepared for the Dateb aerial tramway opening. Fun fact, at a whopping 3 miles, it is the world's longest aerial tramway. But again, I digress. That summer, I met Magar and Anasakisyan, who at the time formed half of the Armenian National Rowing Association. They were half of the team. I spent a morning rowing on the glorified puddle of a lake behind the U.S. Embassy, in the shadow of my old best friend, not Ararat. I was absolutely hooked. I returned the next summer to train for the Under-23 World Rowing Championships, where I represented Armenia in the women's single scull. At the starting line of a rowing race, they pull all the lanes, much like in a track or a swimming race. You say, lane one, X country. Lane two, Y country. The fortunate similarity between my name, Armine, and Armenia certainly amplified the effect, but when it came time for lane six, Armenia, I felt like I was the country, literally. Indeed, a lot of the drunken spectators by the finish line, no doubt spurred on by my own Swedish family who was there in full force, were cheering Armine, yeah. That was a cheer, hammering home this absolutely surreal scene for me. If I had to pick a moment of true concentrated Armenianness in my life, that'd be it. Rowing in a boat in Amsterdam. For me, that moment perfectly captures my perception of Armenian identity. It's dynamic and fluid, yet powerful and staying. It can take shape in anyone, anywhere, with any degree of connection to any part of the culture, language, history, religion, people, or land, because it's a highly personal and emotional draw. Armenian identity can be felt by anyone who cares to engage with it. It does not discriminate. And it goes really well with size Swedish meatballs.
Great job, Armine. And I have to admit, I will not publicly admit, although it's on videotape, that I actually did Irish step dancing for a period of time in my life. Wasn't really pretty, and it was driven because the instructor's daughter was really beautiful, and I really needed to be here. I'm going to introduce Dr. Areg Danagoulian, who was born in Yerevan in 1977. When he was 14, his family made a year-long trip to France, and at age 16, Areg graduated from Yerevan's physics mathematics school, after which his family moved to the United States. Areg has a background in experimental nuclear physics, and is currently holding a faculty position at the Department of Nuclear Engineering at MIT. Dr. Danagoulian.
We Right, thank you for the introduction, and I'm very honored to be on this panel. Thanks for inviting me here, and thank you all of you for coming here so we can have this discussion, which I think is a truly very interesting discussion. So we were asked to specifically think about what does Armenian identity mean, and what are the various components of the Armenian identity? What does it mean? You know, how do you define an Armenian? Okay. So I tried to think about that in two ways. One of them, like abstractly, generally, what is it that makes an Armenian? Okay, you take a random person from the general population. What does it make? What knowledge set? What kind of habits or what lifestyles make an Armenian? Okay. And finally, I thought about where does my Armenianness, so to speak, comes from? So I think, a lot of us over the last couple of years, me, my friends, many people in the Armenian community have been talking about, which direction is Armenian identity going, especially in the Armenian-American diaspora. And lots of people have lamented the fact that these days it appears that being Armenian here means knowing two factoids. One, that we're the first Christian nation, and second one, that we suffered genocide about 100 years ago. Okay. So these are, necessary but highly insufficient conditions for being an Armenian, in my opinion. And I see lots of people who kind of really stay just on those two things. Being Armenian, I think, is a lot more than that, I think. I think being Armenian means knowing Armenian history, knowing Armenian literature, and of course there are lots of challenges associated with that. For example, when it comes to Armenian literature, not all relatively small part of Armenian literature has been translated to English. Nevertheless, significant amount of it has been translated to English. So it's important as we are bringing up our children Armenian, we're trying to bring them up Armenian, we should try to encourage them to also be to expose them to literature, to history. Okay, and it's not such a trivial task. What is helping with this is that recently, with the internet, with the data revolution, more and more Armenian material is ending up on the internet. So it's becoming a lot more accessible. The books that said 20, 30 years ago were completely inaccessible because they were in some library in Yerevan or in some village in Armenia, now are showing up on the internet. They are being translated to English. So, there is that essential resource that you can draw from for essentially cultivating your Armenians, so to speak. But I think big part of being Armenian is essentially being aware about what's going on in Armenia, what are the current affairs in Armenia. Okay? That means not only knowledge about the political situation, but also the social situation in Armenia. And I really put a big emphasis on that, because ultimately, that Armenia is the huge source of kind of culture that people can draw from. So many of the panelists have traveled to Armenia. That's a really great thing. And that seems to be a fairly new thing, historically. Over only the last 10, 15 years, diaspora Armenians have been traveling to Armenia. Okay? During the Cold Wars, in the Soviet time, that was a lot harder thing to do. So that actually encourages me. When I see diaspora Armenians in Yerevan, to me that's extremely encouraging. And why it's also encouraging is not only because that allows those diasporas to essentially to cherish their Armenianness, but because that allows those diasporas to bring the Western culture to Armenia. And I think that's critical for the survival of Armenia. Okay. Armenia is has big part of the Armenia's own culture is a leftover of the Soviet past, okay? And I think in order for Armenia to become a stable, secure country in the future, it needs to become transparent, it needs to become just, okay? It needs to suppress corruption, okay? In the political life and in their everyday life. And I think diaspora Armenians can do a great contribution to Armenia by bringing their Western culture to Armenia, okay? That can serve an example that it would bring is Israel, okay? Israel is a Middle Eastern country, and yet it's the only country in that area, okay, which has real democracy, okay, that's flourishing. Okay. Why? Because lots of that was brought there by the Jewish community after the Holocaust. Many Jews traveled to Israel and became Israelis. They brought that culture with them. And I think the Armenian diaspora can do the same with Armenia. Now, the second question was specifically individual for me. What does it mean to be Armenian? So individual cultures, individual identities are really defined by your paths in life, your life experiences. Okay? And your cultural identity is only part of your individual identity. Okay? Like personally, being Armenian is only part of me. Okay? Being American is also a very big part of me. Being a scientist is another big part of my my being, so to speak. As far as my Armenian identity is concerned, I grew up in Armenia, so in a way, it was kind of easy, right? I grew up in the Armenian society. It's a no-brainer you're going to become an Armenian. You don't have to go and look for books on the internet and stuff like that. You just live there, and as long as you are doing a good job, you go to school, you get decent grades, and you are aware of what's going around you, you will become Armenian. That's the easy part. So that kind of came natural to me. The part, but the two big events that had an enormous impact on myself feeling as an Armenian was the Karabakh movement that started in 1988, which was a big revival of Armenian awareness, so to speak. And that's when all of us really started to think about, well, who are us Armenians? So we started really reading up on history. We started taking care of our language. While before it was very common for people to speak a mixture of Armenian and Russian, suddenly people started taking care of their language. They started to speak clean Armenian instead of mixing it up with whatever was convenient. And something else that really had a big impact on my on my view of Armenianness and Armenia as a whole, Armenian society, were the events during the Karabakh War. So I was, Sheriff Koutoujian mentioned, I traveled to France as a kid, and then we came back to Armenia in 92. And we're in Armenia from 1992 to 1993. And there was the war, war completely took off. There was devastation during the war. There was a massive economic collapse. Over winter of 92 to 93, we had 1 hour of electricity. We had water that would get turned on once every 2 weeks, and would accumulate that, and would use it very, very carefully. Everyone learned everything about plumbing, about electricity. They knew how to conserve every little resource that they had. Okay. At the same time, there was a very devastating war that was going on. And lots of Armenians from Armenia, when they remember those times, they remember it as really difficult, hard times, which it was. But I remember something that was amazing about those times that I've never seen anywhere else. I've traveled to many countries. I've lived in France. I've lived in Italy, United States. One thing I've seen during that period I've never seen anywhere else is how much people helped each other. People were helping each other like crazy. I mean, we could go to our neighbor's apartment and get water for them, okay, at any time of the day. Okay. Really, you could really see this community that was really holding together. So that sense of communality that Armenians had really saved the society. Okay. And when I remember those times, I remember pride for seeing so much humanity in fellow Armenians, and so much strength, so much stamina, and so much communal feeling, essentially. So, with that, I'll end my.
That was really interesting. Thank you so much. Now, my pleasure to introduce Alison Hamlin. Allie grew up in Ipswich, Mass. Growing up, her exposure to Armenia didn't extend much more than the kitchen. Her general words, not mine. Right, Allie? This year, Allie spent 8 months in Armenia as a volunteer with Birthright Armenia. She holds a degree in chemistry from the University of Rochester, and she currently works in Cambridge at the Journal of Visualized Experiments. Allie?
Heritage is much like everyone in the audience here tonight. My great-grandparents came to America in 1924 through Ellis Island, and my grandfather lived in Watertown his entire life. My mom grew up in Watertown. My grandfather died when I was 3, and so I didn't really have that much exposure to anything Armenian besides through my mom and my uncle. and they didn't speak Armenian. My mom cooked her grandmother's recipes growing up, and so, you know, my exposure was really through the kitchen. And I always knew I was Armenian, and I would say that to people because in America there's, you know, often this dialogue of, oh, well, what are you? And you talk about your heritage, and, you know, I say I'm Armenian, I'm British, I'm Norwegian, I'm Irish, I'm all of these things. And so I didn't really know what it meant to be Armenian. I didn't, you know, for many years, I didn't know where Armenia was. And so it was just this far out abstract thing for me for much of my life. And then I found out about Birthright Armenia through an old friend. And my parents had instilled in me a love of travel from a very young age. And so when I found out about Birthright, I found out that Birthright would support me in going to Armenia and would help me find a productive work placement where I could gain experience and I could live with a family and I could learn Armenian in a part of the world that I didn't know anything about. I said, sign me up. And so I went to Armenia in January and had planned to go for 4 months and I stayed for 8. I lived with a host family in Yerevan. And for much of my time in Armenia, I really struggled with this idea of cultural identity and what is cultural identity. And, you know, in many ways, it's just this abstract thing that defines us, but what does that really mean? And sometimes I would think, well, am I Armenian just because it was written on someone's birth certificate way back when? And, you know, I'm learning this language and I'm, you know, living with this family and experiencing this culture, but what does it really mean for me? And echoing Armine, I also experienced a lot of this inferiority because I was considered less Armenian than many of my peers. And as a Birthright volunteer, you know, you're in this community of diasporans, and, you know, I'm meeting people from around the world who are Armenian, and there's this dialogue of your heritage and where are you from, and it often the conversation would go, well, how Armenian are you? And I'd say, I started to really hate this question, because I would say in the beginning, well, I'm a quarter Armenian. But what does that mean? You know, you can't define something like that by a number. And so I started to say, well, my grandfather was Armenian. And then the person would reply, and they'd say, you know, and I would respond and say, oh, well, how about you? Because that's the nice thing to do. And they'd say, like, oh, well, I'm full Armenian. And then they'd say, well, do you speak Armenian? And I'd say, like, oh, I'm learning, so what do you mean? And then they'd kind of look at me judgmentally and sort of like, oh, who is this girl in Armenia? And, you know, this is, and the thing about this is that, you know, I have very similar conversations like this very often, and it was only from other diasporans. Anyone in Armenia, anyone from Armenia, I would say, oh, I'm Armenian, and, you know, there was just this immediate, like, oh, you're Armenian, you know, eat 5 more dolma, right? and their eyes would light up, and maybe they didn't know that I was Armenian because I don't look particularly Armenian, and, you know, so there was that excitement on their face, and, you know, they were welcoming and generous. And so I think that was very interesting for me, and so I really, you know, spent a lot of time thinking about my identity as an Armenian and what it means for me. And I think it's only become more clear. I've been home now for 4 months, and in that time, I feel like I've only now started to understand what it means for me to be Armenian. And being Armenian isn't, it's not something that I am, it's not what I've come from, it's not what my family was before, but it's something that I'm a part of. And being in Armenia, I've gotten to know this worldwide network of other Armenians. And being home now, I still keep in touch with many people that I met in Armenia. And, you know, I know that I have these lifelong friends who are Armenian and who all share this common value and this, you know, they care about the country of Armenia and the future of this country. And I think that being a part of that community now is what I think makes me Armenian. So thank you.
Thank you, Ali. That's a great story. Thank you. Thank you for your service to Birthright Armenia. Our next speaker will be Anahis Kechejian. She is an undergraduate here at Northeastern University in the study behavioral neuroscience. What an amazing panel, isn't it? In addition to working as a fellow on my congressional campaign, she participated in the Leo Sarkisian internship with the ANCA in Washington, D.C. as well. 3 years ago, she proposed and successfully executed the Stand Up for Your Survivor endeavor, which she will present a moment about after this discussion. She approached the State House Genocide Commemoration Committee with a proposal to involve more youth in the program while also honoring the legacy of survivors. This has been a successful component every year. Anahis recruits over 50 volunteers from the AYF membership, her Sunday school and high school classmates, and several other Armenian youth organization members. And my own children that attend the Armenian Sisters Academy also stood up for their survivor as well. It was a powerful day for me in the chamber of the State House. Anahis Kechejian.
Hi, everybody. So I've been Armenian since day one, I guess. I grew up in Arlington, Massachusetts, so very close to Watertown. I was a graduate of the St. Stephen's Armenian Elementary School, and upon finishing high school, I graduated from the St. Stephen's Saturday School and the St. Stephen's Sunday School. So it's been a lot of Armenian stuff growing up, and it hasn't been too hard for me. You know, all those opportunities have really always been 20 minutes away in Watertown, and my parents have tried so hard to teach me Armenian, and Antrenig and I have always seen our parents put in a lot of effort to making sure that we know the language and all of that stuff, but really without the help of the teachers at the Armenian school, like Diginar Denis, Diginar Nahid, and all of the wonderful staff that work over there, my language skills wouldn't be where they are today, and my reading and writing skills definitely wouldn't have developed to where they are today. So big shout out to them. They're awesome. I've also been really involved in Camp Hayastan. I spent 6 years as a camper, and in the summer of 2013, I worked as a counselor on the staff. And so that's been an awesome way to really connect to other Armenian people who are, you know, just hanging out and having fun and getting to know each other, and we all come from different backgrounds, and it's just a good way to mesh together. And a camp is a really magical place, not to add a cliche, but there's no other way to describe it. This past summer, I was in Washington, D.C., participating in the Leo Sarkisian internship with the Armenian National Committee, and 24 hours after finishing my multivariable calculus exam, I was on the plane with a I can do anything mentality and going to Washington, D.C., and really quickly it dawned on me that I have a pathetic background in geopolitics, and I have no idea what was really going on. I had a nebulous understanding of the situation in Syria. When I got there, I had to dive in and start doing a lot of homework about all the House resolutions that we were promoting, like the Turkey Christian Churches Accountability Act. I had the privilege of seeing that pass through the Committee of Foreign Affairs in D.C. So I had to do a lot of homework, and I thought I had been doing all the right things, like going to Armenian school and participating in Camp Hayastan, but really at the end of the day, I don't think that my identity as an Armenian culminated until I understood what was going on politically in D.C. With all of the initiatives that are being pushed in that office, every day people, I don't know if you guys know the ANC staff in D.C., but they're awesome, like Kate Nahavetjan, Rafikina Karakashan, Angedo Yelso Chuljan, everyone knows Adam Harparyan. Really seeing them work so hard every day to promote PITAD and those initiatives made me so inspired to come back to Boston and promote the Armenian initiatives that we have, because our clout in D.C., it really allows us to get a lot done and protect Armenia as best we can from over here in the States. And so that was awesome. I got to, in the office, I got to contact all the 2014 midterm election candidates, both for Congress and Senate, and gauge whether or not they were interested in supporting our initiatives with, you know, Nagorno-Karabakh, the Genocide House Resolution, the all sorts of stuff. And so I spent, you know, 8 hours a day on the phone, you know, talking to them and fielding questions about the ANCA. And I also did a lot of research on human rights violations of Armenians living in Turkey. And when I got to D.C., I didn't really know what a human rights violation was. And by the end of my time there, I was sitting down with Kate Nahavetjan and another, and the two people who write the human rights reports for the State Department, and talking to them about things that are listed in the State Department reports and things that we find in our research that aren't included, and why are Armenian issues not really, you know, being monitored as closely as, you know, other violations of human rights for other ethnic groups in that area of the world. So that was a really eye-opening experience. I learned a lot about myself and a lot about the Armenian community all around the world, and it was really awesome. So I guess my Armenian identity is really defined by my experience and my involvement. In Boston, about 3 years ago, I created and organized a project called Stand Up for Your Survivor. So I think I'll speak about that towards the end, but it's really awesome. And I find that our community is really united by our political initiatives. And that's something that we can all stand behind and support. And it's really been a big part of building my Armenian identity, for sure.
Now I'm going to pose a couple of questions that have been suggested by the committee. So you have to use all 2 minutes, and I'm not going to be timing you. I'm assuming you will be pretty aware of your time. So we want to get through as many questions, not only these questions, but also from the audience as well, which I think will bring some really interesting, because quite honestly, in each of those presentations, there was a couple of really interesting pieces that I was really blown away with, and I hope we can explore them on a very personal level tonight, too. There were really some fascinating moments during those conversations. So I will begin, Armine, with you. When you interact with other Armenians, are you aware of your different backgrounds? By different backgrounds, I mean Amerigahai, Berutsi, Baskahai, Hayastansi, you know, the different generations. And, you know, we all remember back, by the way, when first the Lebanese Armenians were coming into Greater Boston, and no one knew what to make of this strange new breed of Armenians that were coming to our community. We were all diaspora Armenians that have been here for a period of time. And now the Lebanese Armenians, including your dad, Armin, are very much part of our culture. We're now joined by Hayastansis that have come here. And I see a couple of my friends that are out here today, maybe because Areg is here, that are becoming part of our community, and yet we're not connecting with as much as we've spoken about this before, as much as we should and we'd like to in the future as well. So when you interact with our other Armenians, are you aware of their different backgrounds, where they've come from, their experiences, and if so, in what ways? And is this diversity a source of strength or weakness, Armine?
Sure. So one thing that kind of stuck out to me when Ali was speaking, actually, is she started with, as with many of you in the room, her grandfather came over, da 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 da. So that experience to me is one that's I'm starting to have my eyes open to. I, as Peter said, grew up with a Beirutzi dad, and all of our family friends are either from Syria, so either Halatzi from Damascus or from Beirut. that was the Armenian experience I was familiar with. I grew up blissfully unaware of different delineations, Armenians within Armenians. And I'm talking not just where you're from, but where your political beliefs are, all the churches. My parents decided to mess with everyone, sent us to three different churches, and just raised us as everything. So I didn't know. And all these words started coming out at me when I was like 11, 12, I would guess. My friends would start asking, or someone would say it offhand, like, and I still don't know what some of them mean, honestly. I'm not interested in knowing. I'm interested in getting to know people. So I think it's really interesting to me, like, hi, Asante, people that come over, for example, for school or something like that. You get to know their story. Do I care about the context of, like, all high Asantes are X? No, I think that's stereotyping, and generally try to stay away from that in good practice. I think that there is a great strength in our diversity in general. So I can see why people would, especially when they first come to the country, affiliate with that. I mean, like I said, there's a reason why all my family friends are either Beirutzi or Halutzi. Like, that's just what I grew up with, because they all knew each other. But I think, you know, on the other hand, the reason why I don't find myself really, really interested in getting to know all of the delineations of Armenians and Armenians, because I don't think that's particularly productive. I guess.
Thank you. Dr. Danagoulian.
So, in terms of, you know, various kind of various diverse kind of subcultures of the Armenian culture, you know, I've lived in Armenia, I've lived in France and the United States, and I have essentially I've been embedded in various Armenian, both two large Armenian diasporas, in France as well as the United States, and also in Armenia, and so we, of course, I've met Armenians from many different parts of the world. I've met Lebanese Armenians. I've met lots of Persian Armenians, Pashtuns, you know, Armenian Armenians, of course. And of course, we're all there, quite different. Okay, of course, we have our own individual subcultures within the Armenian culture. Okay, and I find that great. In fact, if to extend this, in Armenia, there's many lots of local cultures that are very different from each other. I would say more. I would say that Armenians from Karabakh, Armenians from Yerevan, Armenians from Chavar, where my father's from, actually, that's where they drink lots of vodka. The differences between them, not like that, necessarily like that. The differences between them are much larger culturally than, let's say, differences between Pashtahai and Lebanahai and, like, third-generation Armenian who live in Boston. And I think those differences are fantastic, you know, as long as at the end, you know, we are in a way united around some common idea. And I think I do see people being united around common idea. There are some people who do say that, oh, we Armenians should be completely united, we should completely erase every differences. And that's, you know, that's absurd. That's not going to happen. And it is, I think lots of those people who say that, their fears come for historic reasons. When you read, like, end of 19th century Armenian writers, okay, like I don't know, Rafael Balkanyan or Abed Tikisarakyan, lots of those writers end of 19th century used to complain about the fact that in those days, many Armenians used to identify with their local village and not identify with Armenianness in general. That was overall a problem. Armenians were not united around this common Armenian idea. They were united around the idea of their church, their village, local church, local village, and then maybe being Christian. Okay? But, you know, we have gone long ways those days, okay? And those fears should be, you know, left behind. Also, something else I want to add, you know, like, I heard stories about, you know, about being like 100% Armenian or only 25% Armenian. You know, Armenianness is not a tank of gas, okay? Like you say, oh, you know, my tank is full, yours is only 25%. You know, Armenianness is a metaphysical idea, okay? You don't measure it in percents and things like that. Right?
Who's next, Ali?
Yes. I'll say in the context of birthright, which to me is my Armenian community, that because I haven't had really any exposure and experience with the Armenian community here in Boston, and I'll say that this is kind of my first introduction to the Armenian community, and I'm excited to get involved in the future. We're back to the question. You know, interacting with Armenians from around the world, it always comes up, where are you from, you know, all of these different things, you know, and these words are thrown around, and I think the global community of Armenians, it's such a unique history that we have, and, you know, many other cultures don't have that history, and that diversity. And so I think diversity is always a strength when you approach it in the right way. And I think I agree with what Otto said about, you know, it's a strength when you're all working towards a common goal. And I think that, that's the most important thing.
Thank you.
I can't think of a better example of Armenians from different backgrounds coming together than our club at Northeastern, the Armenian Student Association. We have a girl from Turkey, we have a girl from Dubai, we have a bunch of us from the Watertown community in the Boston area. And I mean, maybe when I was younger, it was kind of weird to think, like, oh, these people are Beyrutsi and these people are Varskahai. But now it's something that it's just like a part of the dynamic, and it's really cool to be able to talk to people about their different backgrounds and the different subsidiaries of Armenian culture. The same is true at Camp Hayastan. You know, I had the privilege of listening in on some conversations about the Varskahai community and the Beyrutsi community and what they do differently and how they refer to different foods and go about doing all sorts of stuff. Also, when I was in D.C. In the Capitol Gateway House, I lived with two boys from Yerevan, and it was so cool to be able to talk to them about, you know, their schooling experience in Armenia. I got to play chess with them a few times. They beat me like 4 times in 1 minute. yeah, I beat them once by the time I left D.C., and I was pretty proud of myself. Yeah, and I got to hear their Abadansi jokes, and I had never realized that those were a part of our culture because I was just over here in Watertown. yeah, and so I've had a lot of positive experience interacting with people from, you know, the different parts of the Armenian community and, you know, getting to know what makes them so unique and awesome.
Thank you, and yeah, how about a hand for each of those? I think when you were speaking, I had to think of the joke when you speak about the Armenians sort of not communing with one mind often, and I still remember the joke, you know, when you had two Armenians in one town, you had two schools, two churches, and 3 newspapers. And when I tell that to any other community, thinking they have it all over us as far as their own community and being of one mind, Jewish community, Irish community, many others, they'll say, no, that's us, we're crazy, we don't get along at all, you people have it all together. Quite honestly. When I was in Greece, actually, they think the Armenians have it all together. I'm thinking, are you guys crazy? But this is the perception from outside, right? And I just think that the diversity, and I'll just, one reflection that I'll have here. I might even get emotional about this, but I remember Armenian Heritage Park. We all participated in this. And this is one amazing opportunity that we all spoke with one voice. And it was a celebration of our community and our experience here, not just a recognition of our genocide, which is all too often what we come together about. This is a celebration of our experience here in the United States. And if some of you might not know or might know, but during the very early times when there was much of this diversity, 2 schools, 2 churches, 3 newspapers, where I couldn't get a group together to work on this together, and it didn't seem to be able to stick. And I remember one earlier version when there was some fighting among a smaller group that was put together. One gentleman said to me, Peter, you're doing more work on this, and you're only half Armenian. Yeah. I honestly, that stung so much. I mean, I'm emotional thinking about that because I never thought of myself as half Armenian. Never thought of myself. I can't believe you would actually say that. Is that what you think of me? Is that how other people must think of me? And it never dawned on me that I was only half Armenian. So, by the way, if you measure your Armenianness and your your heart, not in your gas tank, right? Now I'm going to ask again, Armine, to begin with you. When you think of your Armenian identity, as you've spoken, many of you have maybe addressed this, but maybe take a different angle on this. Who or what influenced you the most significantly? Who or what influenced you the most significantly on your Armenian identity?
Sure. So let's take a different tact on this. I alluded to this speaking earlier, but it's definitely my parents, hands down. So that was the early influence. A later influence is sport, and I'll get to that after. But so I think the obvious choice, anyone knows my dad and Alan knows me, is to say that my dad really influenced me. It would be a bold-faced lie to say otherwise. He has made time for Armenian initiatives in a way that I admire endlessly. He has a day job for like 50 that keeps him really, really busy. And all through my childhood, I saw him prioritizing Armenian initiatives, and especially, like I mentioned, as I mentioned, when I was 13, kind of redirecting those towards the Republic itself. That definitely inspired me. That I had the latent interest, but that catalyzed that interest into action. What people might not expect me to say is that my mom was actually a huge driver of my Armenian identity as well. Anyone that knows us won't be as surprised, but she grew up in Sweden, has her whole family there, left that life to come to the States and raise a family. I don't know what it was that she was expecting, but I don't think she was expecting four gigantor Armenian children under her care. But she came and she did that, and with three kids under the age of five, she took night classes and learned Armenian and speaks and understands a hell of a lot better than a lot of Armenians I know, faced discrimination and disrespect in her effort to raise us as Armenian kids. And she didn't have to do any of that. Like, she really didn't. No one was making her. She did it out of love, certainly, for my father and for us. But it's also just sheer determination and grit. Decide to do something and raise four children. At one time, their four was under eight, so that's kind of a handful. And be the director of that when you're not even Armenian yourself. Small anecdote, sidebar here. So I have a huge family in Sweden as well. We spent every summer there growing up, and they know how to make hummus from scratch. All of them. And we'll regularly have kebab parties, like panandas, which means like out on the water, out on the countryside, because they didn't have packaged hummus. My dad needed packaged hummus. He needed hummus in his life all the time. And the stuff they had, they're not any good anyway, so we make it ourselves. The secondary point that I'm going to touch on a little bit, and I also talked about a little bit in my earlier talk, sport has been a pleasant and later in life influence on the way I think of myself as an Armenian, working with the Armenian rowers and kind of seeing, you know, a lot of people say math is the international language, it's the Esperanto that people actually understand. I would say sport is a close second. Anyone that's really engaged with and inspired by their sport can go out and find that anywhere else. And regardless of your language barriers or cultural differences or anything else, there's that. You can go out, and for me, you can go row with them. The stroke's different no matter where you do it. I mean, the same no matter where you do it, so.
So in terms of, you know, what is it that helped me become Armenian, it was really growing up in Armenian society. So the kind of, as I said earlier, that was fairly straightforward. But if you ask the related question, which is, which person specifically had an effect on me as an Armenian? Which person was kind of like a role model, as an Armenian that really inspired me about what it means to be an Armenian? Okay, the one person that does come to mind is Monte Melkonyan, who was a famous Armenian. Why Monte Melkonyan, right? There are so many other Armenians over there. The reason I'm really inspired by Monte Melkonyan is because he was an Armenian-American, for those who don't know. He grew up in Southern California, went to Berkeley, and was a typical assimilated, you know, kid growing up in California. And then he rediscovered his identity, okay? And he turned down all kinds of fantastic academic opportunities of going studying at Oxford, etc. Instead, he got involved in Armenian affairs, and very long story short, he ended up in Karabakh, leading the Armenians south of Karabakh in Makhdumi region, fighting against the Azeri onslaught. Okay, and he managed to organize a completely disorganized group of villagers into a serious army, which guaranteed the survival of Karabakh, 140,000 Armenians. But the realism, the one thing about that was amazing about Monte Melkonyan, okay, was the fact that, you know, he was, besides achieving military victories, which are critical, for Armenians around. He also tried to bring, and this is very much related to what I was saying earlier, the Western values to the Armenian culture. For example, he really tried to impress upon his soldiers the notion of gender equality. Okay, he tried in a highly patriarchal society, which is what Karabakh is. Okay, he really tried to, you know, express the notion that women can be equal to men. Okay, he tried to force his soldiers to respect and treat with humanity there as their prisoners. Okay, he really like taught humanity to people around him. He did many other things, you know, along this line. He rejected alcohol. Okay? Tried to, you know, bring the notion of discipline to people around him. Okay, and one thing that really tells about who he was and what he tried to do for Armenia, okay, other than music. One journalist asked him, how do you imagine Armenia, you know, years from now? You know, how would you like to imagine Armenia? And you would think that being a military leader, he would say, I'd like to see Armenia powerful, strong, etc. Instead, what he said was that I'd like to see Armenia full of justice. Okay, I'd like to see basically democracy, he didn't say exactly, but he said I'd like to see democracy in Armenia. Okay. So in that regard, he was like really an amazing person. It's really unfortunate that he died as well as he did. But, you know, he could really be an example of what a diasporan Armenian, the miracles that a diasporan Armenian can do by traveling to Armenia and helping change the country. Okay.
What do you think of your Armenian identity, and who or what most significantly impacted you on it?
Well, I would have to say Armenia, and because that is so much a part of my identity now. And I think a lot of diasporans that go to Armenia with their forebears from Western Armenia, there's this idea of going back to your grandmother's Armenia, and that's simply not the case. But because there's so much that has happened since then, and it's a very different place. But at the same time, you still have these moments when you feel like, you know, I'd feel this connection to this place and this community, and, you know, I'd pass someone on the street and say, whoa, like, are you my uncle? Or, you know, that first look at Mount Ararat, I remember that moment, and, you know, it was magical. And I also, you know, felt this connection to my grandfather and my great-grandmother, who, you know, I haven't spent that much time talking about, but are a very much important part of my identity as well, even though I didn't really know them. And so it's those moments when you can connect to, you know, your family that are really what's important. And then also being in Armenia, you know, it's an exciting time for Armenia. And, you know, Armenia is growing, it's evolving. And it's hard to look at Armenia and spend time there and think, you know, I don't want to be a part of this. You know, it's so exciting. You want to be involved, and it's great to see the growth in the civil society that's starting to have a voice, and these great, excellent NGOs and organizations run by diasporans and local Armenians alike. And so in that way, I think that inspires me to be involved as well.
Really inspire me in the Armenian community are the ones who extend themselves and put in so much effort to make sure that our strong organizations are able to be sustained for a long period of time and really have the impact that we want them to have. So, I mean, I could name names forever, like Tamar Kaneri and Heather Karafi and all the people in D.C. working at the office. Watching what they do every day and how they you know, sacrifice so much to make sure that the high tide initiatives are pushed forward really inspires me. And in general, anyone who represents the Armenian community in the Odar world and is able to, you know, carry themselves in a good way and be a good representation for the Odar people who are maybe going to meet one Armenian in their life, and those who are able to give off a good impression really inspire me, and that's what I aspire to do.
And actually, so Anahis, you're actually hoping to be one of those people who inspires another person to be a significant influence on their Armenianism. Great. I think we were going to actually have a couple more questions by me. Quite honestly, Mark, I'd like to be able to allow the audience a few questions, because you probably want to try to wrap up by 9 o'clock or shortly there before, get to the baklava and the coffee and the
bagel. Yeah,
fair enough. Okay, it's a badge, it's not a star. By the way, for all Armenians, this is a sheriff's badge. It's not a Star of David. Only Armenians think that I put on the Star of David to get the Jewish vote. When I first started wearing this around, it was only Armenians said, why is Peter wearing the Star of David? Only our people. So now I'd like to open it up for questions from the audience. My thought is to ask if it's a specific question to someone in particular, and if the panelists can keep our answers more succinct than even before, quick answers, so we can get as many questions in as possible. Yes? Speak up a little bit too, please.
I think it's a question for everyone in the panel, also that Peter, you as the moderator. I think the reality of assimilation in the United States, the Armenian diaspora is at the danger of losing many of its members. What could the Armenian community in general, and the organizations in particular, do to be more welcoming of what Ali calls less Armenian, Peter, you call half Armenian, and Armin, you talk about your mom's experience as a non-Armenian married to someone who's an Armenian. What is your response to that? How can we become more welcoming of members that we desperately need and we can't afford to lose?
I will put this in alphabetical order. Who would like to while the other three are thinking for a moment?
Could you repeat the question?
Yeah, could you repeat the question again? And she can't even repeat that then, can you now?
Welcoming of individuals who are not fully Armenian. I think we're at the danger of assimilation in the United States, at the danger of our community shrinking, and we can't really afford to lose individuals like Ali, who was really dead. I'm very proud that you are here and talking as an Armenian, and Peter, you're part of us and part of the Armenian community. So, but all of you have had negative experiences, and I wonder if you can enlighten us in terms of ways that we can help you with, not to be part of the Armenian community.
I think it's just about understanding that everyone can have a voice, and that if someone wants to participate, they can and they should be able to. It's just as simple as being welcoming and being open. And for the person that is on the outside who maybe isn't as exposed to the community, I think it's about listening hearing the ideas and hearing and understanding the culture so that you can become a part and be a valuable voice.
So in that same vein, I think it's a person-to-person effort. So I think it's, on a day-to-day basis, I shouldn't have to deal with statements like, oh, you're on time, or you're only half Armenian, you don't really get it. Or even, we'll say, there's no really good way to put it, like someone who's not fully Armenian. That is the way we put it, and I know that's not meant to be offensive, but that's kind of the whole mentality, right? Like, that, it's a one-to-one relationship. You know, when I interact with someone that has other cultures mixed into their background, just being cognizant of that, and if they choose to be Armenian, well, let's open up our arms and give them a hug, because as you mentioned, we can't really afford to lose anyone. If anything, we want more people on our team. So my approach with that, I think, from an organizational standpoint, is just reaching out on a person-to-person basis and not making jokes of of your Armenian status, which, obviously, I did that tonight, so...
Sure. So, as far as assimilation is concerned, assimilation is definitely a credible threat, right, that we have to be concerned about. Now, the question is, what's the extent of the assimilation? And I personally, maybe I'm very ignorant, I'm not sure what the extent of that is. You know, we raise that issue a lot, but have there been done polls that show that less and less Armenians are identifying themselves as such? Maybe they have been, I might just not know about those. Now, the question about, let's assume there is assimilation going on, right? Let's say it's a serious volume. So what can we do, what are the things that we can do to reduce its effects or reverse it and things like that? So obviously, awareness, raising awareness can go a long way. People can be encouraged, for example, to join Birthright Armenian. Now, I mentioned earlier that travel to Armenia can be like an amazing experience for people to just to rediscover their identity, to reaffirm their identity, to really nourish their identity. In terms of actually kind of accepting or rejecting people who are partial Armenians, who, you know, gas tank is not full. I personally have not observed, you know, that, like, I personally, I'm always open to anyone, irrespective of their genetic makeup, in terms of other 50% genetic makeup. That kind of stuff completely doesn't concern me. The real question is that when it comes to personal interactions, it's really how people get along with each other. Obviously, people that are culturally very similar, they come from the same town, they are more likely to, you know, do stuff together. And that's inevitable. That's just inevitable. What we should do is that people who are, who say, might be worried that they won't be accepted to the community, they should be very told in very clear language that no, nobody's going to discriminate against you just because you don't happen to be 100%. You know, if you're interested, if you choose, that's what determines, though. If you choose to be Armenian, that's your choice. Okay, nobody can tell you, no, even though you chose, you are not, you know, good enough. You know. So.
I don't know how to start answering this question. There are so many different things I could talk about. What I find with, or at least at Camp Hayastan, if someone joined later, it's really hard to break into the Armenian community, especially like when you're talking about like middle school kids and all of that age group. It's very hard to butt in. And if you don't go to camp before you're 15, you kind of miss the boat in terms of like making good connections and good friends. And then when you show up at an Armenian event, you're not going to know anybody. And it's just like this whole negative cycle of like, you know, falling out of the loop, so to speak. And so I think it's important that we are more welcoming. We talked about this in AYF Senior Seminar in October this year about how we as a community should be reaching out to those people who aren't involved so much right now and making them more involved and bringing them into the loop. And it's a big effort because you don't see these Armenian people every day. And when I'm at a dance or an event, I want to run over to my Camp Hayastan friends or my Northeastern friends and, you know, catch up with them. So it's we have to be very aware of it and really try to interact with people who are out of the loop and bring them into the loop so that they want to come back to things and be more involved and have fun and be a part of the gang. And,
Very good. Thank you. So, just from my own perspective, briefly, assimilation isn't necessarily a bad thing. With it, as Areg mentioned, you tend to lose some things, right? You know, a little bit of the language, a little bit of some of that. But the fact is, you gain also. I mean, my mother made the choice to join our culture. That wedding was on one side you had your Armenian crowd, and you had your repressed Irish crowd. It was my big fat Armenian wedding, is what it was. You know, see the pictures where my grandparents were all like this. My mother was worried about string cheese. She thought there were rat droppings in the string cheese. You know, these were wonderful experiences. My mother's Irish, and my mother's Armenian now. You know, I want to say something about. I spoke about Zabtok and getting elected to office. You think about the two most prominent Armenian Americans who have been elected recently are myself and Rachel Caprilli. And, you know, and we've done pretty well for it. Now, I don't mean this for myself. I mean about our community. We've done pretty well for ourselves. We were elected very successfully. We were pretty prominent. We did well in the legislature. We went on to do greater things. The governor appointed me as sheriff. The governor appointed her as registry of motor vehicles. She's now Secretary of Labor and Workforce Development. We're doing a great deal to bring, I mean, and trust me, anytime we're in the statehouse, we used to aggravate the heck out of people, because anytime Rachel and I were in the statehouse, we weren't talking about, you know, legislative issues or anything. We were talking about Armenian issues. Half of it was therapeutic. Oh my God, you can't believe what Rafi just said to me now, or, you know, just all the things that we were going through every day. But every time we were together, we were speaking about Armenian issues. Every single time. It became an absolute joke. So what were we able to do? What were our parents able to do? Also, one thing that I always think was, so we were both successfully elected to office. And sadly, there's really no one in there right now, right? No one that identifies themselves as being Armenian anyway, unless it's convenient. There's one legislator that used to identify himself as being a quarter Armenian. Suddenly, when Speaker George Gavarian became Speaker of the House, as George had said, I didn't even know he was Armenian until I became Speaker of the House. But it was funny because it wasn't, when I thought about it, Rachel's mom was Irish as well from Georgia, my mom was Irish, but you'd say, well, it was the Irish that, Irish like politics, that's how he got involved. No, it was both of our fathers that were the ones that became involved. So I will say this, part of a lack of assimilation can be problematic. And I will say this, I've said this many times. On Monday night, we've got Abaca. On Tuesday night, we've got the language lessons. On Wednesday, on Friday night, we've got Cafe Anoush. You know, on Thursday night, we've got something else, right? On we got the Knights of Vatan dinner on Saturdays, right? Every night, we've got something to do as an Armenian. And I have seen so many strong and amazing and powerful young Armenians like these people here that have simply been lost to the larger society and never be able to influence the rest of society because they're stuck doing Armenian things every single day and night of the week and the year and never branching out. And it is such a loss and a sadness to see never being able to take that talent, that drive, that passion to educate the rest of the world. So yes, assimilation is unfortunately is natural and can be, we can lose some things. That's just the way it happens with the world. And that's not a good thing. We should try and hold on as much as we can about our culture, about our language especially too, right? But on the other side, if we don't assimilate, we're never going to grow, we're never going to influence, we're never going to impact the rest of the world. And quite honestly, we're never going to bring the blessings of who we are as these great people, this historic and amazing nation. We'll never be able to bring those blessings of that to the rest of the world in some ways too. So I think assimilation is natural and I think assimilation is good. And by the way, you know, it's really the only time that someone said, you know, anything that slighted me about being not fully Armenian. And honestly, I never even think about that really. Just it was shocking that some people might, I never think of myself as anything less. And I don't think that people generally do now anyway. I think we've also changed a bit. Why don't we just do one last question? Oh my goodness. All right. Should we just, we should probably stick to one last question, Mark. I've got to go with Celine, sorry. Celine. I'm sorry. And if you have questions after this, I'm sure the panelists, I'd be glad to sit and speak as well.
Growing up for me, having an Armenia, an independent Armenia, was the dream we sang songs about. Look forward to 2016. 100 years have come and passed. Perhaps recognition of genocide has now, we've achieved it. What is going to be the unifying force of our community? I mean, now is the genocide, but look forward. You know, we achieve it. What's going to, what do we fight about? What do we fill a room with? What are we going to go?
Good. Right. I'll say a few things. Right. So the question is, you say, you know, genocide is a unifying thing that unifies Armenians. But is that a good thing? I think it's a bad thing. Genocide should not unify anyone. It's a problem. Genocide is a problem. It's a trauma. Okay. We have to do things about it. Okay. When we fight for genocide recognition, okay, what we're doing is that it's like therapy. Okay. It's like we're trying to recover the trauma that has gone through generations, okay? And by fighting for genocide recognition, we're essentially fighting that inherited trauma, okay? Genocide should not have become a unifying thing for Armenians. Our culture should have become a unifying thing. Our language, our history, the things I listed should have become the unifying thing. But I'm glad that people are finally asking that question. So let's be positive about it, right? I think, you know, nowadays that we have Armenia, maybe we can finally, you know, unify around Armenia by going traveling over there, by doing a few things that I mentioned, you know, and turn that into a unifying element of our, you know, our culture.
And you don't all have to answer this question, so anyone else want to take a crack at it?
I think it's not the history.